thank you for being with us. It's been a long and exhausting week. So many things have happened, but I want to start off by saying God is good. Yesterday, I received news that Narissa, our sister Narissa Sterling, she received news about her test, came back negative. Praise God, praise God. We also heard about Herbie. He went into a procedure and everything is fine. So God is still working in the midst of us. And so today we're starting a brand new series. We're talking about the story of a lasting legacy, the gentleman's edition. Last month we dealt with the women, but this month we want to deal with the legacy of men. And so last time I briefly walked you through about justice and how in the Bible there are four words that talk about justice, two in the Hebrew, two in the Greek, and it appears 1,060 times in the Bible. And I mentioned to you how I've never heard a sermon, I've never heard a Bible study dealing with justice, and even though it's mentioned 1,060 times. And so real briefly, real quick, before we jump into the message, I want to remind us what justice is in the Bible. Justice is the deliverance of the poor and the powerless from injustice. It's lifting the foot of domineering power off the neck of the dominated and oppressed. Is stopping the violence and establishing peace. It's restoring the outcast, the excluded, the exiles, the Gentiles, and refugees to the community. And so last time I was here, I mentioned to you that in the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, there are four issues that the Bible speaks on that we as Christians should also stand up on. It says that Christians ought to be sold out for racial justice. It says that Christians should be deeply concerned about the poor. It says that Christians should be pro-life. It says that Christians should believe that, at least for Christians, that sex should be only between a man and a woman in marriage. But here's the problem. Our church, and I'm specifically speaking about the Seventh-day Adventist Church, we have been silent on these issues for so long. So what has happened is that the political parties have hijacked those ideals and they've adopted them into their platforms. So if you are a Christian that's for pro-life and for marriage between a man and a woman, you're considered a conservative Republican. If you are a Christian for social justice and racial equality, you're known as a liberal Democrat. You see what the devil has done? He has brought division in the house of God. And that's why I mentioned last time that before you are a Republican, before you're a Democrat, before you're even an American, we are Christians and we should stand on the ideals that the Bible speak on. But now, all this week, we've been looking at the racial unrest in this country. And look what it has done in our church. Here's something that I found. It says, how do you know if you've made an idol out of your politics? When you see the war on racism as a battle of the left versus the right, instead of seeing it as the kingdom of God versus the kingdom of darkness. Because that's what it's all about. It's God's kingdom versus the enemy's kingdom. The kingdom of the enemy is about division. Our church, our Ellen White, our prophet, who we believed had the spirit of prophecy, look what she says over 100 years ago. And she wrote this to Minneapolis. Look what she says regarding race. The desire to show their masterly authority over the blacks is still burning in the hearts of many who claim to be Christians, but whose lives declare that they're standing under the black banner of great apostate. When the whites commit crimes, they're often allowed to go uncondemned, while on the same passion is let loose and all the suffering that can be devised is instituted against them. Will not God judge for these things? As surely as the whites have brought their inhuman cruelty to bear upon the Negroes, so surely would God's vengeance fall upon them. I was confirmed in all I had stated in Minneapolis that a reformation must go through the churches. Reforms must be made for spiritual weakness and blindness, whereupon the people who have been blessed with great light and precious opportunities and privileges, while we endeavor to keep the unity of the spirit in the bonds of peace, notice what she says, we will not with pen or voice cease to protest against bigotry. Notice what she said. Imagine if the Adventist church in Minneapolis would have listened to her counsel. Maybe George Floyd would be alive. But instead of standing up, instead of being obedient, we have hid in our churches. That is why last Saturday, myself, my wife, my son, Brandon, Maria, Francisco, Rhonda, Maurice, and others, we went to Coral Gables for a peaceful protest. Because see, the Bible tells us that you shall love your neighbor as yourself. That's what the Bible teaches. And it says that we should bear one another's burden and to fulfill the love of Christ. And we went there because, listen, right now in America, Black America have a burden. Breonna Taylor's not with us. Ahmaud Arbery's not with us. George Floyd is not with us. And so we are hurting. The Blacks in this country are hurting. And it's up to us as Christians at this moment to stand by their side. See, we went there last Saturday. And this was organized by a Latina young lady and an African-American young lady. And we started with prayer. And we heard the different stories from our Black brothers and sisters. How they, when they walk down Coral Gables, when they walk down even Little Havana, how they feel discriminated. They feel the hate. And I know some of y'all, they're exaggerating, but listen, that is their story right now. And so we marched. The police were with us. And I wasn't there because the march ended in front of City Hall. And after an hour, I left. But the police, chief of police of Coral Gables and all and the rest of them, they knelt with the protesters. You didn't see that on the news. What you saw on the news was the shutdown of 95. What you saw on the news was the looting and all the violence. And I need to remind all of us, not everybody that is protesting is looting, and not everyone that's looting is protesting. And so this is where now as Christians, right, we need to stand and we need to bear the burdens of our Black brothers and sisters. This broke my heart this week. Did you see this picture? This is the daughter, Gianna. And she says, "Daddy changed the world." A six-year-old. I don't know if she saw the video of her father's death, but she recognizes that now the world has changed. And so what has happened now? See, and this is where my advice to all of us, stop watching the news. Your pastor gets on his car, he turns on NPR, I get my 5 minutes of the news, I shut it off. Because what you need to understand is that whether it's CNN, whether it's Fox, they are pushing their agenda. They are pushing their thoughts. And the Bible says, by beholding, you become changed. So the more you listen and the more you watch, you are becoming changed. And that's why when I said that Black Lives Matter, I'm not talking about the organization. I'm talking about Black lives like that little girl. But let's bring it a little home. I was talking about the Black lives in our church. That little girl, Gianna, she says, my dad changed the world. And I want to let Nathan know. Nathan, your life matters. I want to let Sienna and Aiden, your life matters. I want to let my boy, Sean McKenzie and Mustafa, your life matters. I want to let Sanea and Christian, their lives matter. Now, someone may say, well, Pastor, why are you not mentioning Veronica and Dwight? Listen, their lives matter. But here's the thing. These young people, these children have seen someone that looks like them murdered in front of the TV. And right now, they may be thinking, my life doesn't matter. In our church, as the pastor of Miami Temple, I can't speak about the Adventist church, but I want our young people, Amara, Alyssa, Peter, Samantha, Peter, Aaliyah, those that I have not mentioned, your life matters. And you know what? You're beautiful. God has a plan for you. Now, someone says, but Pastor, what about Jakey? Doesn't his life matter? Man, I love Jakey. That's my little rocket raccoon. But come close to me right now. Because, see, it's not Jakey that's being made fun of. It's Victoria. She's in kindergarten. And on Sunday, Josie tells me that little Victoria went home because they were teasing her in her classroom because of her hair. Little Victoria, you're beautiful. Your hair is beautiful. And right now, it's like Kirk Franklin. He says, listen, yeah, all lives matter. Yeah, it's like all houses matter, right? All houses matter. But when there is a house that's on fire, the fire department is going to go and turn off the house that's on fire. Black homes are on fire. It is not the time for us now to, well, what about us? Right now, they're hurting. Right now, we need to come and become next to them. Right now is the time for us to be quiet. And when I heard that from Josie, it took me back to my own daughter. My daughter, when we were in California, in an Adventist school, she thought she was less than because she didn't have blonde hair and blue eyes. And then they asked her, do you speak Mexican? This is in an Adventist school. Now, I didn't hear of this till we moved to Miami. And let me remind my Latinos, we need to stand with our brothers and sisters because right here in Miami-Dade, we experience racism. Do you remember this? Some of you who were here, the Cubanos, remember? We the people speak English. Dade County does not. Cuba speak English. One country, one flag, one language. Stop the Cuban takeover. That happened right here. So right now, us Latinos, we need to stand with our black brothers and sisters. But can I be honest? This was hard for me. This week was very difficult for me because I knew I had to preach. And I know that some of you may be thinking, well, he's gonna give us a piece of his mind. Well, man, then you don't understand the responsibilities that we as pastors and preachers have. I'm not a stand-up comedian. I'm not a political commentator. I am a messenger of the Lord. I speak for God, of God. And I'm not here to give you a piece of my mind. I'm here to share God's heart with you, God's mind with you. And right now, Latinos, nosotros sabemos que en nuestra cultura tenemos raíces racistas. My Latin brothers and sisters, you know that in our roots, we have racism. I heard growing up, not from my parents, but from my family, oye, no dañe la raza. Don't ruin the race by bringing and dating a black girl. I used to hear, right, when there was too much work. And okay, ¿tú te crees que yo soy negra? ¿Tú te crees que soy negro? Right? Oh, there's a lot of work. What do you think, I'm black? We have said those things jokingly. And there's even racism within our Spanish countries. Can I remind the Puerto Ricans, the Dominicans, the Cubans, we all have Spaniard blood. We all have Taino Indio blood. We all have African blood running through us. And so right now, we need to be standing with our brothers, our black brothers and sisters, because truly, we are family. And you know what? Racism. It's not just against the blacks. It's, like I said, it's the kingdom of the devil. In New York, the Italians persecuted the Irish when they came. And when the Irish came and the Puerto Ricans came, now the Irish were beating up on the Puerto Ricans. My wife, you know my wife, Linda and her family, they're all light-skinned. They're white. And Linda was beaten by Irish people. Linda was taken, her hair was being pulled. Rocks were thrown in on their window. Now here's the thing. Linda lived on the fifth floor. So from the bottom, from the street, they would throw rocks. But you don't see my wife hating white people. See, because we understand. Oh, and by the way, when I started dating Linda, and we were walking in her neighborhood, This is in the 90s. An Irish man looks at me and called me the N-word. Yes. And you know what? Confession. When he said that to me, my response was, yo no soy negro. I'm not black. You see? We have been conditioned. We have been conditioned. That's all I'm saying, church. We have to deal with racism. Oh, pastor, what about abortion? What about the immigration? What about, listen, take a number. Because right now, racism has been here. The blacks have suffered for over 400 years. And now it's the church has been quiet for too long. Look what Ivan Meyer said. Ivan Meyer said this yesterday. He said, I am all about the three angels' message. You all know this. But friends, before we can deal with open racism in the world, before we can claim to possess a message that brings healing and unity, we must deal with hidden racism in the church. And Pastor Nelson, next week, he has something for you. I'm not going to take away his thunder, but that's I'm setting him up for next week. So what do we do now, Pastor? Here's what we do. The first duty of love is to listen. As Christians, we should not be the ones that say, oh, but you know, George had a criminal record. Oh, if Ahmaud didn't run. Oh, well, what about Brianna? She was in her house. She was sleeping. Now is not the time for you to make comments. Oh, my goodness, the looting that's happening. Oh, la, 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 la. Shut your mouth. Listen. Listen. Try to understand. Look what my Caucasian brother, Doug Wilson, he put this on his webpage, Facebook and Instagram. He says, as a white man, I hear you. I'm listening. I'm learning. Thank you. That is what Christ would do. And that is what Christians would do. Before I jump into the message, because this is not my message, we are Christians. And in the political world, listen to me. We will never see President Trump. We will never see Obama. We will never see President Obama. We will never see Nancy Pelosi. We will never see Vice President Mike Pence holding hand to hand, walking down in protest. You'll never see that. But as Christians, as Seventh-day Adventists, we should be holding hands. Whether you're a Republican, whether you're a Democrat, whether you're an independent, we are Christians first. So be careful what you put up on social media. Please, the world is watching. And as we're talking about this month, the story of a lasting legacy, I want to remind you that today's footprint is tomorrow's legacy. Today's footprint, what we do today, is tomorrow's legacy. I am so proud of our young people today. I am so proud. Look at what happened all around the world. You know, thank God for COVID-19. I know that sounds crazy, but if it wasn't for COVID-19, Brianna would have died, George would have died, Ahmaud Arbery would have died, and it would have just been a blip. Because we would have been too busy, we would have been too into our own thing, it would have been on the news, and it would have been forgotten. But because God has called us on a timeout, now we have the time to do something. COVID-19 has reset the world. COVID-19 has reset the world. I saw this yesterday. Someone said, hey, 2020 has been canceled. So they're no longer considering, they're not calling this 2020, they're calling it 2019, the sequel, part two. And I saw this, and I just had to laugh. They said, scientists find 33 creatures living in a cave that was sealed off for 5 million years. Look at the comment. Hey, seal that cave back up and walk away. This is not the year, man. This is not the year. 2020 is crazy. But I love what Josephine posted on her Facebook page yesterday. It's a poem by Leslie Dwight. It says, what if 2020 isn't canceled? What if 2020 is the year we've been waiting for? A year so uncomfortable, so painful, so scary, so raw, that it finally forces us to grow. A year that screams so loud, finally awakening us from our ignorant slumber. A year we finally accept the need for change in our church. Declare change, work for change, become the change. A year we finally band together instead of pushing each other further apart. 2020 isn't canceled, but rather it's the most important year of them all. I believe that. We have an opportunity here. Pray with me. Father God, as the world has been reset, your church has been reset. But Father, our individual hearts need to be reset like David. So Father, hide me behind the cross. Speak to us. Revive us. Reset us. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're talking, my sermon today is entitled, A Reset in a Cave of Justice. And I'm talking about David, and I'm going to talk about David for Father's Day. But David is one of my favorite characters. Many of you know the story of David and Goliath, where he was a young man, right? And he faced the giant in 1 Samuel chapter 17. But this is 1 Samuel chapter 22. And if you have your Bibles at home, that's where we're going to be for the rest of the time. Look at Psalms. 1 Samuel chapter 22 verse 1 says, so David departed from there and escaped to the cave of Adullam. What? Wait a minute. In a couple of chapters, he defeated the giant, and people were saying, Saul has killed his 1,000, but David has killed his 10,000. But something happened, and when you look in the Bible, a cave is always a type of dark hour, a struggle, a trial in your life that you face. Remember Elijah, when I preached about Elijah? So what moved David to go into a cave? What moved Elijah to move into a cave? It was fear. And right now, I need you to understand something. Fear disassembles. Fear disassembles. Here is David. He is a champion, and now King Saul brings him into the palace. Now he makes him his personal musician. He gives him his wife. I mean, he gives his daughter as a wife to David. And so David is living large, right? But one day Saul got tired of the song. Saul killed his 1,000, but David his 10,000. And so now Saul is jealous. Fear disassembles. He was afraid that David was going to take his throne. So what does he do? He tries to kill him. And so now David, he has no other choice, but he has to leave his wife, runs away, and he runs to Samuel, his spiritual mentor. And he hides there for a couple of months with the school of the prophet. But now he becomes anxious, and he says, I got to go. So he leaves Samuel. Now here's the sad part. He never sees Samuel again. That's the last time he sees Samuel. See, fear disassembles. Fear divides. Fear breaks up relationship. He left his wife. And so now he's running now to Jonathan. Jonathan is his best friend. And Jonathan is a son of King Saul. And now he says, listen, my father's trying to kill you. You better go. And so now he says goodbye to Jonathan. And here's the second casualty. That's the last time David sees his best friend. The next time he hears that Saul and Jonathan are dead, doesn't see his best friend again. So now Jonathan loses his wife. He lost his position, right? He lost his spiritual mentor. He lost his best friend. And so now he says, okay, I got to run. I got to go. So he goes to the city of Nob. And when he goes to the city of Nob, he goes to the church. And he goes to the high priest and he says, hey, do you have any food? And the priest asks him, wait a minute, where are your men? And David, out of fear, he lies to the priest. And he says, hey, I'm on a mission from God. And so please don't tell anyone, okay? And he goes, by the way, do you have any weapons here? Do you have any weapons? And the priest says, oh, yeah, we got Goliath's sword here. And now David said, great, can I have it? And so now he takes the food. And now David, afraid, he comes up with this stupid idea. I know what I'll do. I'm going to go and hide in the city of Gath. Now, for those of you who are not familiar, the city of Gath is the hometown of Goliath. This is where the Philistines are. So David is thinking, or not thinking, you know what? I'm going to be safer in the land of my enemies. And so he goes, and he goes with Goliath's sword, right? Duh, someone recognizes him. And he says, hey, aren't you David? And they sang the song. King Saul killed his thousand, David his 10,000. So what does David do? The Bible says, 1 Samuel chapter 21, look what he says, look what he does. So he pretended to be insane in their presence. And while he was in their hands, he acted like a madman, making marks on the door of the gate and letting saliva run down his beard. Now he lost everything, and now he lost his dignity. And now he has nowhere else to go. But God sends him to the cave of Adullam. And in the cave of Adullam, he is nowhere, no one is with him. And biblical history tells us that in that cave, he writes Psalms 142. He writes Psalms 57. He writes Psalms 34. And I believe that's the order in which he writes them. Because see, if you have your Bibles, go to Psalms 142. Because this psalm is so relevant to what's happening in our country. Maybe there's someone here today that you're frustrated. Your finances, your job, you haven't been hired yet. You don't know what's happening. Well, listen to what David did. David cried out to God. David cries out to God, and he says in Psalms 142, verse 1, he says, I have cried aloud to the Lord. I lift up my voice to the Lord for mercy. I pour out my complaint before him. Before him, I tell my trouble. See, some of you will tell your trouble on Facebook or on social media. Don't do that. Cry out to God. David is crying out to God. Look what it says in verse 2. Verse 2 says, and when my spirit grows faint within me, it is you who watches over me. In the path where I walk, people have hidden a snare of me. Look what it says in verse 4. Look to my right, look to my left. No one is concerned for me. I have no refuge and no one cares for my life. That sounds like Black America right now. They look, no one is there for them. No one is there for them. They feel alone, they feel abandoned. Well, David knows exactly how you feel, my brothers and sisters. And look at now what verse 5 says. Verse 5 says, then I pray to you. So after he complained, after he yelled, now he says, okay, you are my place of refuge. You are all I really want in life. He says, listen to my cry, for I am in desperate need. Rescue me from those who pursue me, for they are too strong for me. In verse 7, he says, set me free from my prison, that I may praise your name. Then the righteous will gather about me because of your goodness to me. Oh, ladies, brothers, and sisters. As soon as David ended that prayer, God hit the reset button in the life of David. Right here, right now, I want to remind someone, fear disassembles, but God assembles. See, the devil is about dividing us, but God is about assembling us. And notice what God is doing. He heard David said, listen, I am not here. No one is here for me. So God does this. Look at 1 Samuel chapter 22, verse 1. He says, David left Gath and escaped to the cave of Adullam. And when his brothers and his father's household heard about it, they went to him there. God brought his family. And a family is held together basically by the bonds of blood and by the bonds of love. But listen to me, church. David's family didn't believe in David. If you remember when Saul went into David's house and he asked the father, bring me all your sons, call all your sons. He didn't call David. David was in the field. David was this little mocoso, right? A little brat. The father didn't believe in him. His own brothers didn't believe in him. When David says, I want to face the giant, I'm going to kill the giant, the brother says, shut your mouth and go take care of the sheep. So it's interesting that God brings David's family to him. Now, some commentators said, well, yeah, duh. Saul was after David. So logically, Saul is going to go get the family to get to David. But I don't agree with that. My small group, last week, we've been studying the life of Joseph. Remember Joseph in Egypt? And it was interesting that we learned that once Joseph became the second in command, nowhere in the Bible does it tell us that Joseph sent word to his brothers or to his father, hey, I got you. I got your back. Come over to Egypt and I'll provide for you. No, in Joseph's mind, he probably thought his father was dead. And so his papi's dead. My brothers are dead. But see, God is in the reconciliation business. So God moved Joseph's brother to bring him to Egypt, because the reconciliation between Joseph and his brothers needed to happen. And so in that cave, the family of David needed to be reconciled with David. And so God brought the family together. Work with me, follow me now. And I want to talk to my fathers. I want to talk to my husbands. Not my husbands, you know, the men of the church. The Bible says in 1 Timothy 4:16, talking about legacy, watch your life and your doctrine closely. Persevere in them, because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers. Men of the house, your children are watching you. Men of the house, they're watching and they're listening to what you're saying, especially in this pandemic, especially during this racial injustice that's happening. Our children are watching us. So it is not the time to let loose. You need to be an example in your home. You need to lead your home in worship. Your children need to see you opening the Bible. They need to hear you sing. They need to see you lead out in prayer, because that is the role of the man. That's the legacy. And so God brought David's family together because David needed that emotional support. But look what happens next. God not only brought his family. In verse 2, it says, and everyone who was in distress, everyone who was in debt, and everyone who was discontented gathered to him. So he became captain over them, and there were about 400 men with him. Discontented, look what it says. The Hebrew word means to be in bitterness of soul, to have been wrong, and to be mistreated. Man, there was a lot of men in that place that can resonate with how our black men and sisters are feeling. But here's what happens. God brings those that are in debt. God brings those that are discontented. God brought those that were in despair. See, God brings David a family, but now God brings him an army. And see, he gave him emotional support with his family, but now God is saying, okay, I'm going to give you practical support. I need you to train these men to be your army. And see, those men, those 400 men became known in the Bible as David's mighty men. So listen up. They started the story. These are the guys that are discontented. These are the guys that are in despair. These are the guys that are in debt. But see, when they came into that cave, David, through the power of God, transformed those men into somebodies. Those men were with David, and they were the ones that helped him get into the throne. Many of those men became part of his royal cabinet. See, an army is held together by vision, by commitment, and by order. Now check this out. Verse 3. From there, David went to Mizpah in Moab, and said to the king of Moab, would you let my father and mother come and stay with you until I learn what God will do for me? Listen to me, church. At the beginning of the story, David, when he was afraid, he tried to resolve the issues himself. And there's many of us in this time that we are afraid, we are trying to deal with the situation ourselves. But you could see, as God reset David, he brought him a family, he brought him an army, but now David's heart has been reset, because now he says, listen, can you take care of my mother and father? Because I don't know yet what God wants me to do. See, the David of old would have been like, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to go kick some Philistines' butt, and I got this. But now his heart has changed. And now he's realizing, I'm a servant of God. He's being humble. Now notice what happens in verse 5. In verse 5, the prophet Gad tells David, don't go back to the cave. I want you to go to Judah. The prophet says, listen, training day is done. Your mission to raise up an army is done. It's time now to leave the cave, and it's time to go forward. But here's the part that blew me away. In Psalms 142, he says, set me free from my prison that I may praise your name. And so the prophet of God says, listen, I need you to leave this cave, this place that has been comfortable for you, this place where you had your family and you had your potlucks and you had your training and you had your seminars. I need you to leave this, and I want you to go to Judah. You know what Judah means? Judah means praise. And so as he's leaving his prison, God is saying, okay, now you're ready to praise. Baby, during this pandemic that we have been in our cave, by the way, this is why I'm dressed this way. This is cave gear. We're all in this pandemic. We are held up in our caves. And God is trying to do something in our hearts. Do you know what Adullam means? Adullam means refuge, the justice of the people. God sends David. God sends all those men that were discontented, in despair, and in debt, and he sends them to a cave of justice. And right there in that cave, he hits the reset button. And now David, who went in as a fugitive, he's coming out as a king. And by the way, he doesn't get his throne immediately. Saul was after David for 7 years. The story that Karen played for the children's story, right? It skipped chapter 22 and it just jumps to 24. So in chapter 24, David was in En-Gedi with his men. And now Saul's like, okay, I got him. I got him. He's in En-Gedi. And so now he has to go to the bathroom. That's what it says. He needed to relieve himself. But what he doesn't realize was that David was in the cave. And while he was doing his thing, you know what I'm saying? The men tell David, hey, here's your chance. Here's your opportunity. Take the throne that God has given you. But see, David's heart was reset. And David says, no, I will bring no harm to the Lord's anointed. See, that's what happens when you are in a cave. That's what happens when you reset. And so in this cave, David receives his justice. The people receive their justice. And this story is very applicable for us today, because as I'm landing the plane, God has reset the church. God has hit the reset button in our church. And what he said to Miami Temple, he says, Miami Temple, it's time for us to be a family. A family that is held together by the bonds of the blood of Jesus Christ and by the love of God. Now is not the time. Now is the time that we need to be in small groups. Now is the time that we need to hear the stories. Now is the time. Wilney wrote a beautiful story on Facebook about a white Jewish grandmother who showed him kindness. And he says in Facebook, look, if you want to know the rest of the story, call me. But see, here's where I want to challenge us. God is resetting Miami Temple first and foremost as a family. See, church has changed. Just like airports have been changed ever since 9/11, your idea of church has been reset. Now is the time where we have to become a family. Not where the church doors are open and you run here, you sit in the same pew that you sat, you sang the song, you put the offering, and you left. Right here, right now, God is resetting us. We are all in this cave, and God is saying, I need you to be a family. This is where now I need my black brothers to invite our white brothers and sisters My white brothers and sisters need to invite our black brothers and sisters. Our Hispanos need to invite our black brothers and white brothers and sisters. And we need to sit at our table, not at the church in a potluck. I don't have to form another round table discussion in the church. You want to hear that? Many churches are doing it. What we need to do is pick up the phone and say, hey, I don't know your name. I want to know you. Tell me your story. Can you come over for Sabbath lunch? Can we go somewhere? Right? Because right now, we're allowed to be in groups of 10, social distancing. Right now, God is calling us to be a family. Right now, if you're not in a Sabbath school, you need to be in a Sabbath school. Right now, you need to be in a small group. Right now, you need to be part of prayer meeting. Right now, I know we didn't do the empty foyer today, but the whole point of the empty foyer is not for you to receive a Bible study. It's for you to say, hello, hey, I'm here. We're still here. We need to come closer as a family. Here's the next thing. God is resetting us to be an army. God is resetting us to be an army of volunteers. An army is held together by vision, commitment, and order. An army of the Lord, we're unified first by the love for our God. The next thing is our love for each other. And the third thing should be the love for the lost. God is asking us, we need to raise up an army because we need to go and rescue those that are lost. We have forgotten that. We've been hiding in our caves, but the gospel of Jesus Christ needs to go. And as you can see there, put up the slide back, because now we're talking about when is the church going to reopen? The Florida Conference sent us an email this week, and they said by the end of June that most churches will be, if the state allows, will be opening, the smaller churches. But Miami Temple, I need you to understand something. I'm going to need an army of volunteers the day we open this building. Because now we're going to need, by the CDC's guidelines that I have heard, right? We're going to need people that are going to take the temperature at the door. I'm going to need someone else that's going to be handing out the mask. I'm going to need someone else who's going to escort those of us leaving at the end. And we were thinking, right? The pastors were thinking, well, maybe we can have one service, right? Because of the pandemic and the CDC guidelines, we may have to have multiple services. Hello, somebody. And after each service, I'm going to need an army of volunteers to wipe everything down, to clean, to disinfect the bathrooms every time that someone uses them. And by the guidelines, it's one at a time. We need to clean after and So my friends, we are going to need an army of volunteers, which is why I'm going to be honest with you. I'm not in a rush to get back into this building. You know what I'm in a rush for? I'm in a rush for our church to represent the logo of our church. Wherever your home is, that is church. Look what Ellen White says. Ellen White says, time is short and our forces must be organized to do a larger work. She says, if there's a large number in the church, let the members be formed into small companies to work not only for the church members, but for unbelievers. If in one place there are only two or three who know the truth, let them form themselves into a band of workers. And the last thing she says, the work which the church failed to do in a time of peace and prosperity, she will have to do in a terrible crisis under most discouraging, forbidding circumstances. And so this is not just talking about the work of spreading the gospel. It's talking about also the work of racial justice in our church. What we failed to do in the past during times of peace, now the church needs to step in. And let's do some work to make sure that black lives matter, all lives matter. Everyone needs to know the gospel of Jesus Christ, but it's gonna take a reset. God has hit the button. God has reset the button, and he's looking for Miami Temple to first be a family, and the second thing, he needs a reset for us to be an army. But before that reset happens, my heart needs to be reset. Your heart needs to be reset. Go into your cave and cry out to God, and don't leave until God tells you what you need to do. May God bless you.
You're the God of this city. You're the King of this people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are.
You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are.
There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. For greater things are yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things are yet to come, greater things are still to be done in this city.
You're the God of this city. You're the King of this people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are.
You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the homeless. You're the peace of the restless. You are.
There is no one like our God.
There is no one like our God. Greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done in this city. Yet to come, greater things are still to be done here.
There is no one like our God.
There is no one like you, God.
For greater things have yet to come. For greater things are still to be done in this city.
Greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done. We believe in you, God. Greater things are yet to come. Greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things are yet to come. Greater things are still to be done here. Greater things still to be done here.
greater things are still needs to be done here in Miami. The truth of the matter, church, is we don't know when we're going to be back in this building. Part of the guidelines is that everyone who's over 65 cannot come to the building. They're telling us that we can't have Sabbath school. The children can't have Sabbath school. So we have to now think, and I believe God has reset us, because we are all over Miami. We need to have a home group in Homestead, in Cutler Bay, in Kendall, in Miramar, in Hialeah. We need to start gathering, and like she talked about, small companies need to rise up. Because if you think that the work is going to end in this building, you have been mistaken. I think God has hit the reset button for a reason, for us to be a family and for us to be an army. And I'm going to ask if the guys in the back, if you go to the next slide. So what can we do? There is a doctor, Jamie Cowlesser. He's an Adventist pastor. And starting today, for those of us, okay, what do we do? What do we do? What can we do to learn more? He's having this, he has a social justice strategic plan that this week there's going to be fasting and praying for justice. Next Saturday, across our Adventist churches, we're saying it's a national day of lament in all our churches. And then in June 19, we're saying, hey, for the next 6 days, 8 days, go buy black. Go support the black businesses. See, this is what you can do right now. What else can you do? Pick up the phone. Talk to our members. Invite them into your homes. Hear their stories. Hear how even the white people have faced discrimination. Hear their stories. Latinos, talk about your story. Blacks, share your stories. And we need to build bridges here in Miami Temple. I can't wait for the General Conference, North American Division. But we can do something here in Miami Temple. Today at 6, if you could show the next slide. Today at 6, there is a live stream that's happening, and our own Dr. Judy McCullough is going to be in this panel where they're going to discuss the intersection of Christianity and social justice. Right now, let's educate ourselves. Let's, you know, read books and listen to podcasts. I thank Marvin who constantly sends me things. So I want to know. I want to learn. I want to grow. I need to be sensitive. And so I want to remind us, we're a family and we're an army. Father, as we go, Father, I pray that this discussion may continue in our Sabbath school, that they may brainstorm, okay, how are we going to do this? How is this going to look like? Because, Father, Sabbath school is the key. The home churches will begin first through our Sabbath schools. So, Father, I thank you for the teachers and the leaders that have extended their meetings, not just on Saturdays, but they meet during the week, and they're building community. I pray, Father, now is not the time for no one to be alone. David was alone. He tried to do it by himself, and God brought a family. Right here, right now, I pray for the Miami Temple family. Bring us closer together and form an army so that we can finish the work that you started and that we may praise your name. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. See you next week.
My name is Christine, and I am part of the Miami Temple family. This month, we are going to celebrate the story of a lasting legacy from the perspective of men. Stay with me as I share with you 6 things you need to know about Miami Temple. Join us every Saturday at 11 a.m. for an online worship experience. We encourage you to tell your friends and neighbors so they too will be blessed. Go to our website, miamitemple.org, Facebook Live, or our YouTube channel. We have Saturday Bible study classes for all ages. Online Children's Sabbath School starts at 10 a.m. before our live stream worship service. In the afternoons, we have several web classes for the youth and the adults. Visit our website for more details. Join our Wednesday night prayer meeting at 7:30 p.m. via Zoom. Email us to get the Zoom access code. For our teenagers, visit MT Youth on Instagram for more information. Join our prayer line Mondays through Saturdays at 6 a.m. Email us your prayer requests and our prayer warriors will be praying for you. We have been able to continue spreading the gospel through your tithes and offerings. We thank you for generously supporting Miami Temple's local church budget. Here are five ways to give. It is important that we stay connected. Subscribe to our e-news and iNews through WhatsApp by emailing your mobile number. And as a bonus, you will daily receive Pastor Lafitte's Just a Thought. And as always, follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. For more information, visit our website. I'm Christine Delgado, reminding you to reach out to someone over the phone. God bless you all, and I will leave you for now with God's message.